give this, this talk. I have to admit I was a little bit surprised to be asked to do this. I'm not really known as an African speaker, so the only reason I can think of that I was asked is that I'm very old. It is true that I started as a postdoc at Parkes 12 days before the first Pulsar paper, Hewish et al., was published in February 68. Sorry. So I have in fact been around for almost the whole history of Pulsar. I can't hope to cover all of the interesting things that have happened in the last 50 years in a short talk, so I'll just touch on a few of what seems to me to be the high points. It's influenced by my own experience, so the points that I'll discuss are mainly observational, they're mainly in the radio, but it's not exclusively that. In fact, I'll start with something in which I was not involved at all, and that was the discovery of Pulsar. So, Osama introduced this a little bit this morning, but I'll perhaps say a little bit more about this. It may be of interest to some of you who don't really know the full story. So, this is Tony Hewish, and this, of course, is Jocelyn Bell. Tony was interested in interplanetary scintillation. And he built this so-called 4-acre array in Cambridge to study interplanetary scintillation of quasars. It operated at a low frequency, 85 MHz, and in order to study scintillation, you had to have a very short time constant on the receiver. So could record rapid fluctuations up to 10 or 20 hertz. And it turned out they were just the properties that you needed in order to discover pulsars. So the array was finished in 1967, and Jocelyn was given the job of analysing the chart recordings that rolled off this instrument. In the end, she looked at 4 miles, which is about 6 kilometres of chart recording. So it was a huge job. But she was a very diligent student. And in the course of this, she noticed these so-called scruff things. There was a lot of interference which tended to go equally above and below the baseline, but she noticed there was a slightly different class of object which was primarily going positive. The key breakthrough, and really the discovery of pulsars, was when she realised that these particular ones that went mostly positive repeated at sidereal interval. So they came back 4 minutes earlier each day. And that meant that they were related to the stars and not to something driving around Cambridge. So that was really the breakthrough, and that happened early in August in 1967. They digested that chart recorder on the back end of the instrument, and for the first time on the 28th of November, they saw individual pulsars. So whether you say this is the discovery of pulsars or this was, it's a bit academic really, but it was certainly in late 1967. And as I said, the Nature paper was discovered, they always published in February 68. So as everybody knows, Tony Gerrish was awarded the Nobel Prize in 1974 for this discovery. Jocelyn wasn't recognised, and that caused a lot of angst amongst various people. But I think in the end, Jocelyn is now much more famous than Tony. She's made a career of advocating women's rights and education and so forth, and has become very famous. So that's the story of the actual discovery. The first Parkes observations were made just a month after the Nature paper came out. And it's quite remarkable that in that month, a team from CSIRO and Sydney University was able to assemble a system with five receivers with concentric feeds, so they actually make simultaneous observations of whatever they pointed at. There was only one pulsar pointed at, so CP1919, the first one. I was, in fact, in the control room on at this time, and saw these first pulsar observations at Parkes. I wasn't involved at all. I had just started at Parkes. My first job was to write programs for the first computer that they were about to get, the PDP-9, and I was just learning astronomy sort of on the side. Anyway, those were the first observations of Parkes, and they were in fact published on the Australian $50 note. As well as in the country. This is the Parkes radio telescope. Australia changed to decimal currency just at this time, 1966 was. And the $50 note was a couple of years later coming out. And Brian Robinson actually organised to get all this astronomy onto the note. So this is the first observation of CP1919 made at Parkes. I pointed the telescope at the position of the pulsar, and this huge burst of pulses came through, and I saw that. The pulsar was never as strong again as that. It was a scintillation maximum. These other things relate to science that goes on at CSIRO, and this was the chief of CSIRO at the time. So later that year, in 1968, toward the end of 1968, I was asked to help Radhakrishnan observe the polarization of the Vela pulsar. I've been working the OH receiver measuring the polarization of OH masers, and so I knew something about how the receiver operated, and so I was asked to help Brad. Brad had been at CSIRO for a number of years. He's obviously Indian, but his history is quite remarkable. He's the son of C.V. Raman, the Nobel Prize, and the cousin of Chandrasekhar. So he always felt that he was the sort of black sheep of the family. But he was a very bright guy, and realized the importance of these polarization observations, recorded this swing and position angle that led to the rotating vector model, or as Brad always insisted on calling it the magnetic pole model, in fact. And he didn't like this term, rotating vector model, but actually I think it's a better name, because the vector doesn't actually have to be the magnetic axis of the star. Anyway, that was the origin of this famous model. Then, early in 1969, we're doing some follow-up observations on the polarization, and so we set up the equipment to synchronously add the pulses at the expected period of the pulsar, which had been extrapolated from earlier observations. And we noticed that the pulse was drifting across the screen. By this time it was quite late in the evening, so Brad said to me, "Well, I'm going to bed. You find out what's wrong with the system, and we'll look at it in the morning." So I spent all night trying to find out what was wrong. I looked at other pulsars and checked all the connections and so forth. And I couldn't find anything wrong. And so eventually we concluded that there was a real change in the period of the pulsar. And that, of course, was the first glitch that was published a month or so later, along with a companion paper by Reichen Downs, who had also seen the glitch at the office. So that was kind of fun. So pulsar searches, I mean, we all depend on pulsar searches to find the objects that we're interested in. And it's almost universally true that any large-scale search might find lots of pulsars, but the thing that usually turns out to be the most interesting is something totally unexpected. And pulsars have a continual history of turning up unexpected things. And I think it's that that's kept people like myself interested in pulsar astronomy for up to 50 years. They're just fascinating objects which are always surprising us. Anyway, this next part, I'm not sure if you can see it from the back end of the room, but this is a plot of the rate of pulsar discovery. So back here it's 1968, first pulsar discoveries, and the colour coding is by the observatory at which the pulsar was found. So Molongo was very successful in the early days. It doubled the number of known pulsars back in 1968, and then again it doubled the number known 10 years later in 1978. So initially it was very successful. Then there was a bit of a lull. And then the PAX multi-beam receiver was installed, and PAX then made huge discoveries in the number of pulsars. In fact, nearly 60% of the known pulsars have been discovered at PAX, and more than 800 pulsars have been discovered using this multi-beam receiver alone. So people often ask me why PAX has been so successful in discovering pulsars. Well, there are three main reasons. Oh, that's Molongo, sorry. That's the Mahanalei Telescope, which is near Canberra in Australia. It's a mile long, 1.6 kilometres long. And so there's a very big collecting area, and it was very well suited to finding pulsars in the early days. Anyway, this is the Parkes telescope, more or less as it looks now. So it's got a new surface in the park. And it's a remarkable fact, I think, that this telescope has found more pulsars than the rest of the world's telescopes put together. In fact, quite a few more than the rest of the world's telescopes put together. So, as I say, people often ask me why Parkes has been so successful. Well, there's three main reasons. The first is that the galactic centre passes right over here at Parkes. And pulsars are concentrated in the quadrant toward the galactic centre. So that's probably the most important factor, just the location of the observatory. But there are two other quite important factors as well. One is that we have a fantastic group of engineers at CSIRO who design instruments that are way ahead of their time. And in particular, the 13-beam receiver was designed in the mid-1990s. It was installed on the telescope in 1996. And it's still in use. And it's a very, very good receiver, low system temperatures, and with the 13 beams, it's been highly efficient in survey projects, not only pulsars, but also nuclear hydrogen. And then the third main reason is that we had a really good team of people involved in these searches. So this is a photo taken in Bonn in 1999, which is just about the time that we were right in the middle of these multi-beam searches. This is Andrew Lyne, Joe Taylor, who wasn't actually involved in the Parkes multi-beam survey, but was involved in the Mahanalei one, and me. So there were other people, of course, involved in the project, but we really had a lot of experience in finding pulsars, I think. And we concentrated on the job. We weren't too distracted by other things, as tends to be the case these days. And so we were very successful. Okay, so the next big discovery that I'd like to mention is the first binary pulsar. Of course, we all know that was discovered at Arecibo in 1974. It was immediately obvious that this was a significant discovery. First of all, the period was relatively short for the time in the early 1970s. The period was 59 milliseconds. Only the Graben pulsar had a shorter period at that time. And so that was interesting. But what made it really interesting were these huge periodic variations in the apparent period. And it was immediately obvious to everybody involved that this had to be in a short period rather than a century to come. Binary system. And as we all know, this resulted not only was it the first discovery of binary pulsar, it was the first accurate determination of neutron star masses, first observational evidence of gravitational wave, and confirmation of Einstein's general relativity as an accurate description of the motion of these two neutron stars. And both Joe and Russell were awarded the Nobel Prize for that discovery and follow-up observations. I'm sure it was because of the fuss that was caused by Jocelyn missing out, which resulted in Russell being recognised for this discovery. I actually said to him one time that thought he should get half his prize money for Jocelyn, but I don't think he ever did. at this time, actually, I was at UMass. I shared an office with Joe, and sometimes I say that I was about 3 metres away from the Nobel Prize. That was just a bit too far. Anyway, the next thing I'll mention is first millisecond pulsar. This is Don Backer, who very sadly died suddenly a few years ago. He's a great guy. He and a number of other people, Sri Kulkarni, had recognised that that this source, which had been investigated at low radio frequencies, was very unusual and in fact had properties that were quite similar to those of pulsars. So it had a very compact source down here. It scintillated and it had a very steep radio spectrum. So it looked like a pulsar, but quite a few groups, including us at Parkes, Nicky, Dimitra and I, searched this source for pulsations in the 1981 or thereabouts. But we used a sampling interval of 1 millisecond. And I actually remember seeing something funny about the data, about the results from the analysis of this pulsar. But unfortunately, we didn't take the next step, which was to look at it again with a much shorter sampling interval, which Don and Sri did. They sampled it at a few hundred microseconds or maybe even less. And of course they saw these pulsations from 1937. So this was published in Nature in December 1982, and it was, of course, quite astounding that the period was so much shorter than any other travels, the previous record holder. But several people, including Ali Alpar and Radhakrishnan Srinivasan, leapt onto this and put forward the idea that this was a recycled pulsar, an old pulsar that had died, but was in a member of a binary system and was spun up and reactivated. This idea had actually been thought about after the discovery of the Holst-Taylor binary, because it also had a relatively short period and very low spin down rate. So the idea wasn't new, but it was immediately realised that it was the most likely explanation for a very short period of this, this pulsar, and of course that's been confirmed by lots of other observations since. The next thing I'll mention is the first double pulsar, so that was found at Parkes in 2003-2004. It has a shorter orbital period than the Holst-Taylor binary. Its orbital period is every 2.4 hours, and I mentioned this on Monday. It's now a much better test of GR than the Holst-Taylor binary system, and in fact this orbital decay is now measured 2.02%, which is an order of magnitude better than the measurement in the Holst-Taylor system. So Einstein got it right. He describes his theory of general relativity describes the motion of these compact stars and these highly relativistic orbits precisely as far as we can tell. And it's really incredible that the first theory of relativistic gravity, general relativity, and the have been many, many other theories of relativistic gravity since then. Einstein got it right the first time, and many of these other theories have been brought out. So I find that quite amazing. I doubt that he was an absolute genius. Just briefly mention the Fermi discoveries. I had an arrow pointing to them on that history of pulsar discovery. Some of you may have noticed. Fermi's been very successful finding pulsars, especially millisecond pulsars. These red diamonds scattered around here are called millisecond pulsars. Most of those have been, the new discoveries have been found by identifying a Fermi source, which is compact and has particular spectral properties, which have been shown to be characteristic of pulsars. In particular, they have a turnover, a GeV or so. And so Fermi has actually increased by a large factor the number of these systems. Many of them turn out to be the so-called redbacks. I think maybe some black widows as well. And because of the eclipsing of these systems, they're actually quite hard to find in unbiased radio systems. But if you have something to point out, you can really beat it to death. And these systems have been shown to be millisecond pulsars. And in many cases, then they've, having determined the period from the radio observations, they've gone back to the gamma ray data and identified the same period as in the gamma ray signal. Okay, so that's much of the past as I was going to talk about. What about the future? So there's many new large telescopes either being built or planned for the reasonably near future. The SKA, of course, is an important one for radio astronomy. We've all seen pictures of the SKA, so I thought I'd show a picture of this fast radio telescope, which has just been opened in Wuzhou province in China. It's very like Arecibo, but twice as big. And so, 500 meters from one side to the other. Enormously impressive. Telescope, and it will in fact have as much sensitivity for pulsar searches as the SKA Phase 1. So, potentially a very, very powerful system. And then in the X-ray band, I haven't said much about X-ray, but I've put in a couple of pictures of new X-ray telescopes. There's E-Rosita, which we've talked about today. It's a wide field system, the original German survey, and lots of soft X-ray sources. And it also will time lots of pulsars with good precision. And then there's like to, on behalf of everybody, thank the organisers of this meeting. I think it's been a great opportunity for us all to learn about the latest developments in neutron star astrophysics. It's been a great 50 years of pulsar astronomy. It's been very exciting. I think the young people here can now look forward to another 50 years of exciting results of pulsars. So I'd like to say thank you. Paul Choi.